Apple has listened to developer feedback and they've made it way easier migrating your app to Swift 6. Let me explain. Swift 6 was officially released last year at WWDC, and one of its key features was a strong focus on Datarace safety. This was the culmination of a process that was started with Swift 5.5, which started to introduce concurrency directly into the language with the introduction of async await, and was supposed to reach its conclusion with Swift 6, which had the goal of making code Datarace safe by construction. This meant that the Swift compiler would enforce compile time checks that would make sure that at runtime, no Datarace's could happen. However, this nice Datarace safety came with one big drawback, which was the fact that migrating existing Swift code to Swift 6 would mean fixing a lot of compiler errors, because these errors, they were indicating places where Datarace's could happen. There could be so many errors when you were to migrate a large project to Swift 6 that Apple actually addressed this topic in WWDC videos. They shared messages like "don't panic," which is not what you would expect Apple to say when they announce an exciting new feature. So they were definitely aware of this issue. They tried to be reassuring by saying that you could start by solving simple issues first, that solving one root cause could end up solving a large number of compiler errors. They were emphasizing that developers should take their time. They even said explicitly that when your project was split across several Swift packages, you didn't need to migrate all of these packages to Swift 6 at once. It was okay to do them one after the other. But even with this kind of incremental migration path, migrating to Swift 6 was still a very, very hard objective. You might have seen people talk about it on social media, saying that basically their entire experience was just fixing more and more compiler errors. And actually, what I found funny when I saw this message on X was that you don't see the full screenshot of errors in the screenshot of the tweets. This is more of the errors. And as you can see, when you look at the scrolling indicator, there are even more errors. So that was a lot of errors to fix, which meant a lot of developer time. And one of the issues was that this migration to Swift 6 was not even bringing a clear business value. Like, it was preventing potential Datarace, but if these Datarace were not happening in your code, you had made your code safer, but you had not solved existing issues. And so this meant that migrating to Swift 6 was a hard sell for a product team or a management team, because there was no clear improvement being delivered to the end users of your app. And so this led to a situation where a lot of developers felt that it was probably better to wait and see if Apple wasn't going to release the next year at WWDC a better path to migrate to Swift 6, myself included, because you might have noticed that during the past year, I haven't released any kind of content about migrating your code to Swift 6. And one of the reasons why was that I definitely felt that the task was really complex, and I wasn't sure that pushing people to invest time in this migration was the right move. And before I tell you about how Apple has made the migration easier this year, I definitely had to share this meme, which I think totally embodies how many developers, myself included, have come to think about the initial migration to Swift 6. It's a great promise about your code no longer being able to generate Datarace, but the reality is that any kind of variable, so any kind of mutable state, ends up potentially being a compiler error that's painful to fix. So what did Apple announce this year? They made quite a smart observation, which is that originally Swift 6 kind of assumed that any Swift code could be run concurrently and so had to be Datarace safe in that context of potentially being run concurrently. But as it happens, this is not how iOS apps or macOS apps work. On an iOS app, most of the code that is executed is actually UI related, and so is executed on the main thread. And it's only a portion of the code that will be run concurrently. Typically, things like network call, like performing really heavy computations. And that's definitely not the bulk of the code of an iOS app. And so Apple introduced the idea of a default actor isolation, which you can set to the main actor. And what this does is that when this setting is enabled, any Swift code in your project will be assumed as being implicitly annotated with @main_actor and so will be executed on the main actor. To say it more simply, this simply says that by default, your Swift code is single-threaded unless you say otherwise. And how do you say otherwise? There are two ways to do it. The first way is to mark code with the attribute non-isolated. What non-isolated means is that the code is not isolated to a specific actor, and so the code will run on whichever actor it's being called. So if it's being called on the main actor, it will run on the main actor. If it's run on an actor that runs on a background thread, it will run on that background thread. And as you can imagine, such non-isolated code has more potential to create data races, and so the compiler knows that it needs to apply more checks to non-isolated code than for regular code, which is isolated to the main actor by default. And when you need to implement code that has to run outside of the actor on which it was invoked, typically think of things like making a network call, you can do it by annotating the method with the new @concurrent attribute. And when a method annotated with @concurrent is called, its execution will be moved outside the thread of the actor on which the method was called. And as I'm sure you've already figured out, here again, the compiler knows that it needs to put code annotated with the new @concurrent attribute to a higher level of scrutiny regarding data races than regular Swift code in your project, which will run on the main actor by default. And that's the explanation of how in Swift 6.2, Apple has managed to achieve their goal of data race safety while keeping the developer effort to a minimum. Personally, I really like this trade-off that they've made of assuming that by default, code in an iOS project runs on the main thread. I think it's a very smart trade-off. I think it aligns quite well with how most iOS apps are structured. And so I really hope that it will finally make migrating to Swift 6 a more approachable path for most developers, because the goal of data race safety by construction is a very interesting and attractive goal. You just need to have to invest the right amount of effort to achieve it. And if you want to learn more on this topic, and before you start the effort of migrating your iOS app to Swift 6.2, I do recommend that you learn more on the topic than just by watching this video. You can head to swift.org/migration. There you will find the documentation on how to migrate to Swift 6.2. And I also recommend that you watch the WWDC video of this year that mentioned Swift concurrency. I haven't yet watched all of them, but the ones I've watched had some really good quality content. So I definitely recommend that you take the time to watch all 5 videos before you start migrating your Swift code. That's all for this video. I hope that you've enjoyed it. And I hope that now you have a clearer picture of why it should be easier to migrate to Swift 6 mode when using Swift 6.2. As always, if you've enjoyed this video, don't forget to leave a like and to subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss my next videos. If you have any comments or feedbacks, either on the new announcements of Swift 6.2, or maybe if you've attempted to migrate to Swift 6 last year and you want to let us know how it went, please let me know in the comments. I would love to read it. Thank you for watching and see you next time.